Kendrick Lamar is officially retired. I spend most of my days with fleeting thoughts, writing, listening, and collecting old beach cruisers. The morning rides keep me on a hill of silence. Love, loss, and grief have disturbed my comfort zone, but the glimmers of God speak through my music and family. While the world around me evolves, I reflect on what will matter the most. There's beauty in completion, and always faith in the unknown. Thank you for keeping me in your thoughts. I've prayed for you all. See you soon enough. Okay, Llama.
I hope you find some peace of mind in this lifetime.
Tell them the truth.
Ooh, the layering.
Tell them the truth.
Tell them you're...
I've been going through something. Be afraid.
What is a bitch in a miniskirt?
United in Grief has such an iconic introduction. You've got the harmonies, you've got the suspenseful spoken word, and the piano staccato. I especially love the flow of this first verse, and the pitch of his voice is a stark contrast to his voice in the intro. What is this? Oh my god. This breakbeat is yet another contrast to what we've been hearing before, and I love it so much. G-Wagon away from it was all for rap. I was 28 years young, 20 million in tax. Bought a couple of mansions, chef for practice. 20 million in tax? Oh my god, okay.
Post a caption, pray none of my enemies hold me captive. I grieve different.
What?
I grieve different.
Wait, there was no lead in. Like, there was no lead into that refrain. It was just immediate. Oh my goodness, that was crazy. Not only that, but the drums were only cut for like half a measure to highlight I grieve different.
Fair enough. Green eyes said her mother didn't care enough. Sympathize when her daddy in the chain gang. Her first brother got killed, he was 21. I was 9 when they put Lamont in the grave. Heartbroken when I stalled and said goodbye. Chad left his body after we FaceTimed. Green eyes said you'd be okay. First tour sex to pain away. I grieve different.
Jesus Christ. Very heavy topics for an introduction. I mean, I don't know if I mentioned this already, I've never heard anything by Kendrick Lamar. This is my first listen to his discography. Is everything this heavy? Jeez.
I grieve different.
I love the line, I grieve different, but I think that the coping mechanisms that he uses, buying things he doesn't need, having sexual relations with this girl for the both of you to forget your trauma, I think they're normal responses. I love that.
50k to cousins, post a caption, pray none of my enemies hold me captive. So what? Paralyzed the county building controlled us. I bought a Rolex watch, I only wore once.
The strings.
I never swam in.
The song feels like multiple songs in one, like Kendrick had a million different ideas for the direction it could take and didn't want to settle for any less.
I grieve different.
Everybody grieves different. Everybody grieves different.
So true. The rising ambiance makes all the difference here. It sounds like the turning point of a story, like it's introducing you to the rest of the album. You guys know I'm a sucker for piano. Was that jump intentional or was that my Spotify bugging out? I like it so far. It's pretty intense, deep topics already, so we'll see how this goes. N95, like the mask. Actually, I've not had to wear an N95 mask yet. Don't know where to get them, so.
Hello, new world, all the boys and girls. I got some true stories to tell.
Not gonna lie, I was scared this was going to be an anti-vax, anti-mask anthem, but I'm glad I gave it the benefit of the doubt.
The Wi-Fi, take off the money phone, take off the car loan, take off the flex and the white lot, take off your idols, take off the
round. Not a huge fan of these synths. It feels a little dated to me and it's a bit distracting from the vocals.
Take off the fake deep, take off the fake woe, take off the humble, got care.
I wish we had this piano instrumental for the entirety of the verse instead of those power chord synths. They give the track a lot more depth.
Designer bullshit off and what do you have?
Bitch, you ugly as fuck.
You out of pocket.
Two ATMs, you stepping to what? You out
of pocket. I feel like this production is almost too polished for me. I don't know if it's maybe my sound isn't up loud enough, but it, I don't know. Here, I feel like he's criticizing the wealth gap and that the pandemic widened that. Somehow the richer got richer and the poorer got poorer. I agree with that criticism, but he wasn't he just rapping about how he has multiple mansions and expensive cars and jewelry?
All my descendants, they tell me my secrets, say I am too real.
Huh, facts.
I'm hoping for change in curricles, I know the feelings that came with burial cries.
Bitch, you ugly as fuck.
You out of pocket.
Two ATMs, you stepping to what?
You out serving up a look, dancing in a drop.
I'm a sucker for vocal pads.
Can I fit out my truth? I got nothing to lose. I got problems and pools. I can swim with my fate. Cameras moving whenever I'm moving.
That was so powerful.
Whenever I make murder, he's stacking the president, acting the government, taxing my funds in the bank.
28 mil tax? Ouch. Yeah, okay.
What's your life like? Bullshit, gossip.
Even though I'm not a fan of this bridge, the attention to detail in the mixing is so good. It took me a few listens to make the connection between this cancel culture reference and the rest of the track, but I got there. Okay. I will say it's been a long time since I've heard a bass being used like that as like a pseudo lead. That's so... Okay, anyway, I really liked the most of it. He had a really good flow, especially like toward here. I don't know, you saw my face. I was very pleasantly surprised.
Call that black. Okay, lum. Eckhart Tolle.
Okay, I was wondering how you pronounce it because I saw when he posted his website on Twitter, I was like, Oklama? Okay, Llama? Like, okay, Sammy? Don't tell him I said that. Also, it does sound a lot better.
I'm a killer, he's a killer, she's
with the volume up.
Bitch, germophobic, hetero.
I am not for the faint of heart. My genetic build can build multi-universes. The man of God playing baby shark with my daughter, watching for sharks outside at the same time.
I feel like this section is the moment addressed by the album art. He's a family man, a protector, he is the man of God, as illustrated with his crown of thorns, but he still has his faults.
Ask God to speak through me. That's what you hear now, the voice of yours truly.
Wait, I really like that line. I like this highlighted part. Yeah, okay.
Synchronization with my energy chakras. The ghost of Dr. Sebi paid it forward, cleaned out my toxins, bacteria.
The cinematic instrumental is beautiful. I wish we heard it in larger doses.
The first time I fucked a white bitch, I was 16 at the Palisades, fumbling my grades.
At first I thought this was a really strange experience to bring up, but it's valid, you know. Why bring race into it? But it makes sense. It was his window into this like rich white people culture that was alien to him.
I found out that he was a sheriff. That was a win-win because he had locked up Uncle Perry. She paid her daddy sins. Next time.
And symbolically, this event was retaliation for him. Oh my God, he's being so straight up about everything. This is what happened. It took me a while and some genius annotations to grasp that he's talking about cancel culture here too. I'm still not exactly sure how it ties into the aforementioned racial retaliation unless he brought it up knowing that people would try to cancel him for thinking that way. I'm also wondering how it ties into the theme of the track title, Worldwide Steppers.
8 billion people on earth, silent murderers, nonprofits, preachers in church, crooks and burglars, Hollywood, corporate and school, teaching philosophies.
But the instrumentation here is so bluesy inspired, I love it.
What's your body count? Who your sponsorship? Objectify so many bitches, I killed their confidence.
I understand the main message a lot more on this current verse, but I think I was too distracted by my cat to pay attention. It's so harsh to compare cancel culture to cold-blooded murder, but I think it's more so about how keeping up a positive public perception changes you as a person. The real you doesn't exist anymore. They're dead.
Shopping lies and models, hide your eyes, they pose for the pic.
I really have nothing to say about this because I feel like it's not my place to say anything about this. Do you know what I mean? But I think that's kind of what he's talking about, right? In this section. I kind of got that Kendrick was talking about ostracizing people for their beliefs, but I thought it was specifically about race, like the fact that white people will never fully understand the black, specifically the black African-American experience.
Hey.
absolutely in love with this intro. The tone of this track is already so different from the previous ones. Maybe before he embraced his flaws and now he wants to know if he can fix them. I don't know this artist either. Or this artist. Oh, but I love her voice. This feminine character is giving him space to open up. From what he's mentioned in the last few tracks, I assume that acceptance for vulnerability is not something that he's used to. And I think this is a turning point in the album where we start to see a lot more of his introspective and personal thoughts, like a therapy session. Can I open up? Is it safe or not? I'm afraid a little you were late or not. Have faith a little. I might take my time. Ain't no saving face this time. And this verse is so validating and necessary for other men to hear. You might feel conflicted about opening up to someone, and it's scary. Like, I wear my heart on my sleeve, but not a lot of people feel safe enough to do that. I got some regrets. But my past won't keep me from my best. The around the world panning here was so subtle I didn't call it out, but I love its use on the ad-libs. This feels like Kendrick coming to terms with his sensibility. In one of the prior tracks, he mentioned something about being done with the sensitive. He wanted to keep putting up a front, but now he feels like he doesn't have to. Not that he can't, but he feels like it will help strengthen his family. Baby, you make me pray for London. I was expecting it to stay slow toward the end of this without like the beat kicking back in, just because that's what he's done in the last, I think, three songs. So, interesting. This outro is very light and airy. I hope that means he does feel safe despite his worries. Oh, wait, this is the Whitney that he was talking about before, right? I'm assuming this is Whitney, and then this would be Enoch, and this would be his daughter, who shall for now remain nameless because he hasn't named her. Let me know if I'm wrong, though. This tap dancing or stepping has shown up already before, but I'm too dumb to have put it together as a motif. I come from a generation of home invasions, and I got daddy issues, that's on me. Everything them 4 walls that taught me, may have is buried deep. Daddy issues all across my head, told me fuck a foul, I'm teary-eyed. Wanna throw my hands, I won't think out loud. Kendrick seems to really care about his father's approval. I do too. The difference is that their relationship is founded in distance, whereas I was pretty close with mine. I don't take those well. Mama said that boy is exhausted. He said forever daddy issues. Oh my god. Sampha, I love this chorus so much, and I will definitely be looking up this artist later. I love their voice, and I think that this chorus is so catchy. Oh my goodness, I love that. Okay. His mama died, I asked her why he going back to work so soon. His first reply was son, that's life, and Bill's got no silver spoon. It's really unfortunate because I can sympathize with people who are so jaded and have a life goes on coping mindset. I don't agree with it, but I understand it, and it's really tough on children who need more emotional support growing up. When Kanye got back with Drake, I was slightly confused. Guess I'm not mature as I think. Got some healing to do. I have no idea what happened between Kanye and Drake and Kendrick for him to call them out by name here, so if there are any YouTube docs you can recommend me, please leave the video titles and channel names in the comments. Links get marked as spam, so don't do that. Two things I want to say. One, he is the only person I've ever heard use the W in the word sword. Very interesting. Two, I have a very lovely relationship with my father, and this just makes me feel so grateful for that. I don't know, it's making me sad. Cause everything he didn't want was everything I was. Until my partners that figured it out without a father. Till then, let's give the women a break. Grown men with daddy issues. No chase on me, no chase on me, no chase on me, no chase on me, no chase on me. I would, oh my god, I would, just thinking about this, if my father was like disappointed in who I was, I would not be able to handle myself. I think this one's my favorite so far, just because it hits close to home, but not in a relatable sense, in a I really am grateful for the reality I have, you know what I mean? I don't want to cry.
I learned in trapping in the business, smart people making horrible decisions, you know? Come on, there wasn't no way for us unless we find our own. Running in stoves, kicking in doors, nigga, give me my glory. Nigga, play with me, he ain't gonna live to tell the story. You know, this the type of shit we glorify. Everybody gang gang. Most of the people that you grew up with, lying in the chain gang. In the box getting pink, nigga, shit where you sleep.
I was way too easily distracted by the piano of this to pay attention to the lyrics. It reminds me of Philip Glass's duet from the movie Stoker. Oh my god. This progression is so good. I don't know anything about Kodak Black, but it seems like he's a very controversial artist, especially in contrast to how well-received Kendrick is.
And respect comes first. Yeah, you know, can't be better than the OG. You gotta get it somewhere. Gotta come from something.
Adding more layers and increasing the tempo and modulating up and upping the ante here is actually rendering me speechless.
When it's all said and done, we ain't leaving empty head, we own property.
What a beautiful interlude. Oh my goodness.
Taking my baby to school, then I pray for. Cause you bitches ain't never been cool. Writing testament, painting pictures, put me in the Louvre. That's a definite universal shift. I'm in the cool 72.
I'm not sure how accurate my thoughts are on these lyrics, but for the most part, it seems like he's talking about his past few years away from the spotlight, not releasing any music and focusing on himself and his mental clarity.
Broke phone, trying to keep the balance. I'm staying strong, wait, the aloof.
This line is also referencing the cover art again. I thought that was really cool. That impact. So crisp. I love the bass line in this. Beautiful. The pads in this are so beautiful, really dreamy production.
Frat brother, real nigga, that brother.
His inflection of the word brother was a little jarring at first, but I do think that this one is my favorite production-wise, though. It's so simple in a classic way, though. You know what I mean? I need to stop saying, do you know what I mean? No one is responding to me. Okay.
I pray to God that you realize that
the structure of this track is so chill. Not a lot of musical movement. It kind of stays in one place. You know what I mean? Especially compared to the interlude track, sharing a similar name. I think I was anticipating a change in pace somewhere here, but it never came. But yeah. If anyone knows what he means by 200 lives, is it another biblical verse? The kick is so airy. It sounds like a flat tire. So good. Although, because I was so focused on the instrumental, I was not paying attention to the lyrics on this one at all, so hopefully there wasn't anything bad. Oh my god, okay, all of his intros are so beautiful, and such a lovely take on Florence and the Machine's track June.
This is what the world sounds like.
Very discordant. I would agree. I love the effect here. The voices are muffled and then they become clear as if they are like visually stepping out onto the stage. She has such a powerful voice. I was having a little bit of a connection with this woman here. I've been in relationships where you just fight all the time, and it's so tiring and frustrating to feel dismissed by someone you're supposed to work together with.
You bitch.
Fuck you, nigga.
Nah, fuck you, bitch.
Nah, fuck you, nigga.
Fuck you, bitch.
Nah, fuck you, nigga.
Oh my god. It's like when you're friends with a couple and they're fighting and you don't know what to do. That's how I'm feeling right now.
Bitch, you trying to be good to you. Lost friends, families, game war, enemies because of you.
I've also been in plenty of relationships where my partners have isolated me from my friends and family. I didn't realize until my current relationship that it's a common manipulation tactic to make you feel like you can't leave them.
Just cut me down, that's a big difference. Little dick ass nigga that's trying to go big.
But you were sucking his dick though.
Well shit, I should have sucked his.
What you say?
I should have found a bigger dick.
Bitch, get that bitch.
Give me my...
This feels like it should be in a musical. Maybe I've just been watching too many musicals lately. Only Heathers and Hamilton, but you know.
Keys, bro.
Oh god, you ain't getting these keys.
Give me my fucking keys.
Now you mad at me.
No,
fuck you,
nigga.
Bitch. Fuck you, bitch.
Nah, fuck you, nigga.
No, fuck you, bitch.
Nah, fuck you, nigga.
The sirens here are reminding me of a theme song or something, and it's on the tip of my tongue.
See you the reason why strong women fucked up. Why they say it's a man's world. See you the reason for Trump. You the reason we overlooked, underpaid, underbooked, undershamed. You the reason R. Kelly can't recognize that he's abusive.
Hey, shut the fuck up. We all know you still playing this music. It's a split decision. Bros like you and real victims. Let's talk the truth.
Okay.
Women in general just can't get along. Why R&B bitches don't feature on each other's songs.
What the fuck is you talking about?
Never mind, bitch. I'm walking out.
Whatever, nigga. I'm off.
Wait, no, actually, what is he talking about? I don't understand the point he's trying to make here. A few listens later, I think he's talking about internalized misogyny in women.
Nigga, best watch your mouth.
Pussy in mouth is all you got.
Lay this pussy back on the couch.
Doggy style, then you get on top.
Fuck me, nigga.
I'ma fuck you, bitch.
Nah, fuck me, nigga. Fuck me.
They seem to be in a cycle. I think that they should break up, but maybe that's not my business. Also, I think she might be late for work after this, after all. I was thinking it was like air hockey or like some kind of, I don't know, sports. But I'm assuming it's tap dancing.
Stop tap dancing around the conversation.
Yep. There we go. The production in this one already starts off so strong, but especially in contrast to the last two tracks. This is so pretty.
I know y'all love it when the drugs talking, but shut the fuck up when you hear love talking.
I heard him say in an interview that Kendrick's not really into drugs, and a rallying sentiment from these Genius annotations is that he feels like you can only experience true emotions when you're sober.
Yeah, baby. Yeah, baby.
Yeah, baby. The synths here are so subtle, but they're so fun.
With you, then fuck it up. Fucking with skirts, cause I'm rational. I'm not in the music business. I've been in the human business.
Kendrick is talking a lot about how he feels like social media is toxic and fake and he'd prefer to stay off it. I agree with that for the most part, and I do recommend taking breaks here and there.
I'm blessed that you have an open heart. I'm blessed that you forgive. I'm blessed that you can learn from a loss. I'm blessed that you heal.
I love this section of the verse so much. I bless all of this for anyone watching as well. I hope only the best for you. I like Summer Walker. I only heard her, I don't know if it's her most recent one, but for her 2020 AMAs nomination or Grammys, one of those. But it was really good. Oh, it's definitely the AMAs. What am I talking about?
Yeah, baby. Yeah.
I hate it here. Baby daddy's still on my phone. I hate it here. Asking if I've been on a prowl. I hate it here. Just think I love me more.
I love the soul influence in here. It fits Summer Walker so much. Also, someone linked an article in the Genius annotations about how Summer suffers from social anxiety. She's just like me for real.
While I'm crying, I clean the feet of the sweet Jesus. Dreams, visions get blurrier, the Elohim is like...
The strings contrast ghost-faced... Ghost-faced killer? The strings contrast his voice, but in a complimentary way, and I'm really glad they didn't stagnate the beat here like in previous tracks.
God, please blow the whistle, we need an intermission, my good deeds in front of your door, I'm standing by the entrance.
And I won't go too much into it because it's a bit preachy, and kind of the last thing that I'll touch on. But I left the church for this exact way of thinking, and it's curious to me that both Kendrick and Ghostface are loyal to God, despite all the injustices that they've witnessed. They're asking for God's help, whereas I've already walked away at this point. Alright, and that concludes disc one. I do have to go to the bathroom, so we are going to take a break here. This was a very interesting first listen to Kendrick Lamar. It did get kind of heavy at times, but honestly, you know, I think that those things are important to talk about. Some sections of hip-hop culture, rap culture, where it's like there's that fragile masculinity where they don't want to talk about their emotions, they don't want to talk about their daddy issues. But honestly, I think that from Father Time through Rich Spirit was all so beautifully done. Actually, I'm surprised these have like the least amount of listens, but that was definitely my favorite section of the album. I loved everything. There were some parts that made me a little uncomfy, but I think that was intentional. Like, final thoughts on Mr. Morale and the Big Steppers disc one? Yeah.
We may not know which way to go on this dark road.
Mr. Duckworth.
They use the same melody and style for the intro of United in Grief for Count Me Out, which is really reminiscent of how you'd introduce acts in a play. Although at first I thought I started playing the wrong disc.
Breakthrough.
Oh, so it is
one of these lives, I'ma make things right with the wrongs I've done. That's when I unite with the Father, Son, till then I fight. Rain on me, put the blame.
As I've listened to both disc one and disc two multiple times over, I'm really enamored by how introspective Kendrick is being on this album. Some people have commented that this was a weird first introduction to Kendrick, but I'm really glad to get to know him.
The money don't take things back. It's rare when somebody take your dreams back.
I'm sure the pressures of immense fame have hit him with anxiety. He wants to please everybody, and from what I've heard, he's handled it pretty well. But this is him telling us that the expectations were too high. He's only human.
I fought like a pitbull terrier. Blood I shed could fill up aquariums. If I didn't learn to love myself, forgive myself 100 times, dog. I love when you count me out. 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 Fuck it up, fuck it up, fuck it up, fuck it up, fucking it up. How you gonna wear my trust when the lies run deep? How you gonna bend your love when the bed don't sleep?
The flow of this is so nice. It's been stuck in my head for a few days.
Ain't nobody but the mirror looking for the fall off. I love when you count me out. I love when you count me out. I love when you count me out.
So much of this section is just stops and false starts. It keeps me on my toes.
Sure, sure.
Adding a call and response with the bass is such a fun idea, and I'm definitely stealing it.
Let me tell you about the woman I know.
Oh my god, that was so cool. All the harmonies on this album so far have been simple but really tasteful.
I still could find my circle song. Many fine life in the phone. Good energy in the room, drop the location, please. Anybody out for the one when I'm frustrated?
That whole section of the verse was so beautiful.
Fuck with you from a distance, dog. I love when you count me out. I love when you count me out. I love when you count me out. I love when you count me out.
I've been trying to understand what "I love when you count me out" means in this context. At face value, I think it might mean he feels some kind of relief when the expectation for him is lowered. Him personifying regrets is very interesting. It might be a woman, because Kendrick struggles a lot with infidelity. The end of the track is so powerful, I just need to let it play out.
You said it's not my best. I came about my flesh. Some things I must confess. Spoke my truth, paid my debt. Can't you see I'm a wreck? Let me loose, I digress. This is me, and I'm blessed. 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 Anybody fighting through the stress? Anybody fighting through the...
The piano is very simple here, F sharp, C sharp, pinky and thumb, and it doesn't change until the chorus, but these simple notes give more of a stage play vibe. The right hand leads in to introduce the vocals to the audience.
You can't say no.
These introductions really do sound like like transition stages in a play.
The closest way to say you made the compromise, that's what I call love. One thing I've learned.
I resonate with both the pre-chorus and the chorus because you can't control the way other people perceive you. Actually, I relate in almost the inverse of what Kendrick is talking about here. Because he's talking about how he has built up such an amazing reputation from his fans, but as soon as he does something different, people disregard his hard work up until that point. Whereas I constantly think about how I have friends and family who will only remember me for who I was in a brief moment of my life. It doesn't matter how much I've changed since then.
Tap the feet and nod the head for confirmation. One thing I've learned, love can change with the seasons. I can't please everybody.
I don't know if it'll make sense.
Heavy is the head that chose to wear the crown.
Oh my god. I was gonna say, I don't know if it'll make sense later, but I feel like crown should have been before Count Me Out, just structure wise. I don't know.
Heavy is the head that chose to wear the crown. To whom is given money?
I need to please myself.
And here, he's talking about how he was chasing material things to help fill the void of disappointment, but it's never gratifying. I don't personally resonate with this as much, but I sympathize a lot if you replace cars with, say, titles and social status. And the repetition here is meant to depict how intrusive and recursive these thoughts are. He thinks about it a lot. Maybe the differences in tone and pitch between call and response show that sometimes it's like frustration. Why can't I please everybody? And sometimes it's acceptance. I can't please everybody. I love the vocalization in the back. This one's interesting. I think it's so different from everything else we've heard so far. Like, I don't know. Maybe... definitely like a soliloquy in a play. So far, I love the instrument choice here.
Push these niggas off me like, huh. Push these bitches off me like, huh. Push these niggas off me like, huh. Tucking the broom and shit. Then with a zoom and shit.
I have no idea what tucking the broom means, and I thought Urban Dictionary might help me here. It didn't really. Sounds witchy to me.
You funny dog. Peekaboo can't hide.
Not a fan of this verse lyrically, if I'm honest. It doesn't paint as much of a picture for me as we've been hearing so far.
Swerve, 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 shake the currents off, yeah. Push these niggas off me like, huh. Push these bitches off me like, huh. Push these niggas off me like, huh. Pushing the skin off.
And this chorus is super cheese, but I can't help but enjoy myself at this point. I don't know how to explain it, but if I had heard this song out of the context of this album, I wouldn't like it. Like if I heard it at a club, I would be waiting for the next track to play. You know what I mean? Kind of off topic, but I brought this up in the last, in part one, but I wonder why he has been naming everyone except for his daughter. I think it's like a protective thing, but I could just be looking too much into that.
Bitch, you talk too much. You making this.
They don't fuck with me even if they could. Pull out the stick, hit a bitch with the wood.
Let's talk about Kodak a little more. I've learned since Disc One just how problematic he is. Like, I thought it was just his music that people were divisive over. It's interesting that Kendrick chose to feature him so much on this album. Also, I didn't know that Trump pardoned him? What is this timeline? Also, I didn't know that he was involved in some kind of nightclub shooting in February. I guess that has to have been from right before the making of this track.
I had to survive off a tuna pack. 5% tint on the wood, like who's that? Cool take off like it's mad. Beat the dope with a folk, I'm with me on super fat. I'm doing scams in the lab. Every Thursday, girls, they spend the time with my daughter, make me go harder. Every Sunday, Sunday, teach my boy to be a man, I ain't had no father.
Love that. I was obviously too distracted by the musical ad-libs here, but this verse really ties Kodak Black back into some of the themes of Mr. Morale from Disc 1, like ending a generational cycle and spending time with his children and like still falling victim to your deadly sin. I love the execution of that, but I think it's too strongly panned to my right ear. It's okay. Actually, that's bothering me a lot now, because I feel like not only is it way too panned, it feels much more compressed in this ear.
If you derive your sense of identity from being a victim, let's say bad things were done to you when you were a child.
I think it's so special to have Eckhart speaking in this interlude. I didn't even notice that it was the psychologist that he and Whitney had been talking about in Disc 1 until Auntie Diaries. This interlude is a huge turning point for Disc 2. We're diving into heavy, deeply personal family drama, and I don't think that I was ready for it.
Catch me a body, I put that on anybody but my mama. This year I did 43 shows.
And the strings here are beautiful. The plucks give it a sense of importance, self-reflection.
My heart and the faith, I'm good, love.
I don't know too much about Baby Keem either, but I do find it interesting that both he and Kendrick have now both talked about being prophets and messengers of God, despite the next track pointing out that they are not your saviors.
R.I.P. under my people, I'm proud of my people, I'm proud of my dogs. I love when it ratchet, I don't do a paddock, I still do the watches, the okay. Now how can I fold looking at 20 million? This money don't come with a probate. Mama, I said it'd be okay. I got this shit bragging in 4 days, 4 hours.
This piano section is gorgeous and it kind of ties it all back to the first disc.
Suicide, suicide, Mr. Morale.
Are they actually cousins? I think someone, or a bunch of you, commented about that in the last video, but I think I saw that Baby Keem is actually Kendrick's cousin's son. I think that's so cool. So they have a lot of like bonded family trauma.
Made you think about it, but he is not your savior.
I haven't listened to any of these artists that he's mentioning, but I'm assuming that they are all very well received and have made a huge impact on their fans and maybe even Kendrick himself.
Not your savior. He is not your savior.
Mr. Morale, give me high five.
The transition from the tap dancing to the vocal pads here are so well executed.
Fun fact, I ain't taking shit back. Like it when they pro black, but I'm more Kodak Black. Tell me.
And obviously I didn't catch it on first listen because I didn't know Kodak Black, but this is the line I think is Kendrick's explanation for featuring him so often on this album. What is going on? In this section of the verse, there is a lot to unpack. Obviously, I can't speak from the inside of the Black community, but as an onlooker, I did find the Black Square to be a bit performative. What really stands out to me here is the last line, which I can kind of resonate more with from a minority perspective. It's important to speak out about these things, but if it hits close to home, maybe don't pressure people into being public about their traumas.
Millie, are you happy for me?
Bite they tongues and rap lyrics, really scared like to be course. Crucified about a song, but they won't admit it. Politically correct is how you keep an opinion. At first, I guess I was surprised at how direct the news references were. It feels like Kendrick is making his mark in the history books. This album is where he was mentally while all of the last few years were happening.
Question, Kyrie. Do you want peace? Then watch us in the street. One protest for you.
I love the call and response here, especially with the voice change. It's so grounding, like you want to pay attention to both sides.
The collective conscious. Are you happy for me? Millie, are you happy for me?
Asking, are you happy for me, over and over again is like a way to drill down to the real answer. He wants honesty in response, and the swelling vocal pads in the back are super intimidating, so. I like the reversed impact being used in the beat. It's so nice. And the main message from this song, that Kendrick isn't perfect, he's only human, despite how much he wants to be the prophet, the messenger, the healer, the voice of the people, he can't. He's not perfect.
Paper, capitalist posing as compassionist, be offended me. Yeah, suck my dick with authenticity.
Also, shout out Bandstand, who commented on my Disc 1 reaction so I could find their channel. From their video, they let me know that the song samples Hypnotized by River Tiber, completely transformed. Capitalists posing as compassionates. This intro was a red herring.
This is how we conceptualize human beings.
Oh, it's Eckhart. I had no idea what I was getting myself into.
Monty is a man now.
I think I'm old enough to understand now.
The song is extremely important for the trans community, but also for anyone who doesn't feel accepted for just being who they are. Personality, vocal, avenues on the streetlights. What really hits me about this track is just how matter-of-fact Kendrick talks about it. He isn't speaking to someone who understands, he's reaching out to those who don't.
The road. See, my auntie is a man now. Ask my mama why my uncles don't like him that much. And at the parties, why they always want to fight him that much.
And Kendrick was always accepting, even though he didn't fully understand. I think that's what I love so much about having the song from his perspective and experience. It's realistic. It's honest.
Fack it, we ain't know no better. Elementary kids with no filter, however.
There has been a lot of controversy over this, and I definitely understand why, because it's a very hurtful term. I do remember it being used as an insult, along with gay and the R word and so on. But they're kids. They're just mimicking what the adults around them are saying, and they don't understand that it's harmful. That's the point.
The first person I seen write a rap. That's when my life had changed.
And Kendrick's uncle was a huge part of his life growing up. They clearly spent a lot of time together, got along well, had common interests, and he introduced him to rap.
He trickled down and made us ignorant. Demetrius is Marianne now. He's more confident to live his plan now.
The story is told from the perspective of Kendrick as a child. He didn't understand, but he was trying to. He didn't know that dead naming and misgendering was so personal and hurtful. He loved his uncle, he loved his cousin, and he thought that was enough.
He couldn't climb over. He didn't laugh as hard when the kids started joking. I had to be very mindful of my good cousin. I knew exactly who he was, but I still loved him.
Demetrius is Marianne now.
I wasn't comfortable around me, everything was offensive. But I recall, we both had a sixth sense of humor made raw. But time changes all.
My heart's beating really fast. Oh my God.
Demetrius is Marianne now. Remember church Easter Sunday, which I found ironic because the pastor didn't see him the same. He said my cousin was going through some things.
I mentioned this in disc one, that I left the church because of worldly injustices, and the way that they treat LGBTQ plus people was definitely a big part of that. I felt a lot of guilt for even having crushes on girls. My parents sent me to a church camp for the summer after I came out to them. I was regularly called by my bishop, who would tell me not to act on my sinful thoughts.
Now, I said, Mr. Preacher Man, should we love thy neighbor? The laws of the land that our heart was greater.
I wasn't accepted by the church, and it hurt because I grew up in it. The same is said here for Marianne.
Thinking out loud, bad angel, that's when you looked at me and smiled, said thank you. The day I chose humanity over religion, the family got closer, it was all forgiven.
This is the moment that Kendrick is realizing how hurtful these microaggressions can be. He needed the situation with the church to happen in order for him to fully understand.
Every second you challenged the shit I was kicking. That time I broke a fan on stage to rap, but disapproved a word that she couldn't say with me. You said, Kendrick, ain't no room for contradiction. To truly understand love, switch position. Faggot, we can say it together. But only if you let a white girl say nigga.
Oh my God. And the last line, I remember seeing that concert video posted all over Twitter. I didn't know that it was Kendrick who did that. I just knew that it happened.
Okay.
It's really mature of him to bring it up in this context.
Okay. I wasn't expecting to cry. At all.
It was one of the worst performances I've seen in my life.
The production here is so much darker, it's almost inciting fear, especially with the vocal panting, like he's running away from something. And this first verse starts off especially disorienting, like he doesn't really know what to do.
Like us, who gotta heal them or us? When there's no one to call.
Kind of an aside, but the only time I've heard Sam do outside of this album was from his feature on Stranger by Skrillex in like 2014. And in general, I think this track feels a little out of place between Auntie Diaries and Mother Eye Sober, but maybe that's the point, that he's still having a lot of conflicting and aggressive thoughts. I didn't know about R. Kelly's charges, I didn't know that he was molested, I didn't know that Oprah was sexually abused, so I didn't catch on to this on the first listen, but after looking into it, the connection he's making between these two is something that I think about often. People are just different and grow different from similar circumstances. I had Genius's help for the rest of this verse, the idea that your past life problems are paid for in your present life. I don't agree with it necessarily, but I think that the concept is so interesting. I'm sure by the production alone, these thoughts are rampant and filled with anxiety. It's translated very well here. Who in alignment like us? Who gotta heal them or us? Us? When there's no one to call us? Us? These synths feel very 80s, but it definitely adds to the overall mysterious vibe. Yeah, not gonna lie, I've been tuned out for most of that, still trying to recover from Auntie Diaries, but it's okay.
People get taken over by this pain body because this energy field that almost has a life of its own, it needs to periodically feed on more unhappiness.
The piano here is already so somber, especially in comparison to the last track.
I'm sensitive, I feel everything, I feel everybody. One man, standing on two words, heal everybody.
Despite everything Kendrick's been learning and unlearning in these past few songs, it seems like he still feels turmoil about it here.
Mother cried, put their hands on her, it was family ties, I heard it all. I should have grabbed a gun, but I was only five, I still feel it, weighing on my heart, my first tough decision.
Even though Kendrick was 5 years old in this situation, he still feels guilt for not being able to protect his mother. It traumatized him, and he tries to compensate by protecting the people he loves now that he's older.
You ain't felt grief till you felt it sober.
He did talk about this in the last disc too. I don't know Beth Gibbons, but her voice is so beautiful. It works so well on here.
They accused my cousin. Did he touch you, Kendrick? Never lied, but no one believed me when I said he didn't.
Immediately after this line, I realized the reason that no one believed him was going to be because of his mother. Her abuse was brought up, I think, in the previous track, and as a mother, you never want that to happen to your child.
Again, still they didn't believe me. Mother's brother said he got revenge for my mother's face. Black and blue, the image of my queen that I can't erase.
The entire track so far just feels like a stream of consciousness. This is such a vulnerable look into Kendrick's mind, and he's not sugarcoating any of it.
I did it sober, sitting with myself. I went through all emotions, no dependence, except for one. Let me bring you closer.
Kendrick goes on to talk about how, instead of a substance vice to distract him from his trauma, he turned to cheating on Whitney. And it hurts me so much to know that Whitney blamed herself for it.
I found her in the kitchen, asking God, where did I lose myself? And can it be forgiven? I asked my mama why she didn't believe me when I told her no. I never knew she was violated in Chicago. I'm sympathetic, told me that she feared it happened to me for my protection. Though it never happened, she wouldn't agree. I made it home, 7 years of tour, chasing manhood, but Whitney's gone. By the time you hear this song, she did all she could.
And I think this means that Kendrick and Whitney have broken up, necessary and most likely amicably, because they still care for each other. Whitney is still willing to be such a vocal, instrumental part of this album.
Upon generations and humanity, they raped our mothers, then they raped our sisters, then they made us watch, then made us rape each other. Psychotic torture between our lives, we ain't recovered, still living as victims in the public eye.
His tonal shift here also feels like a shift in narrative. He's no longer talking about his personal experience in a low, quiet voice. He's raising his energy. He's zooming out to the inherited trauma of Black communities stemming from racism, stemming from slavery.
Learn how we cope whenever his uncle had to walk him from school. His anger grows deep inside. progeny. This is post-traumatic, black families and a sodomy. Today is still active, so I set free the power of Whitney. May she heal us all. So I set free our children, make a karma, keep them with God. So I set free the hearts filled with hatred, keep our bodies sacred, as I set free all your abusers. This is transformation.
Oh my god. That was so powerful. The abrupt switch from the rising, swelling verse to the simple piano riff literally feels like a gut punch.
You broke a generational curse. Say thank you, Dad.
Thank you, Daddy. Thank you, Mommy. Thank you, Brother. Mr. Moonwow.
Before I go and fast asleep, love me for me. I bear my soul and now we're free.
I choose me.
Oh my god. And this feels like the end credit song. We have concluded the journey. And I don't think this album could be released at a better time than in May. It talks a lot about mental health, mental issues. From what I've seen, Kendrick and his producers do an incredible job of setting the stage for immersion. At least in this album, I really felt like I was following along. Oh my god. And the chorus is self-acceptance. He is only responsible for himself. He needs healing. He needs to be there for his family.
She woke up in the morning for the other rules. Still you won't grow away no me. I choose me, I'm sorry. I choose me, I'm sorry. I choose me, I'm sorry.
Everything about this production is so lovely. It's full of so many details, and the transients just hit my ears in a certain type of way, you know?
Do yourself a favor and get a mirror that mirror grievance. Then point it at me so the reflection can mirror freedom. Jokes and gaslighting. Mad at me cause she didn't get my vote. She say I'm trifling. Disregarding the way that I cope with my own vices. Maybe it's time to break it off. Run away from the culture to follow my heart. Where will you let me go? I trust you find independence. If not, then all is forgiven. Sorry I didn't save the world, my friend. I was too busy building mine again.
I choose me, I'm sorry. I choose me, I'm sorry.
That's okay.
I choose me, I'm sorry.
It's okay. Oh my god. Majestic. I think that's the word I'm looking for this track. Okay. Okay. That was... I don't think that there could be a better ending to this double disc LP. Oh my god, that was so good. Again, same as with the first one, I'm definitely gonna need a couple more days to really analyze the lyrics and kind of get my thoughts together before putting this out. Oh my god. Thank you for listening with me. I hope that you enjoyed watching me cry. Thanks. I don't even know how to end this. Okay, hope you have a good morning, evening, night, whatever it is, wherever you are. I hope you have a good one. Final thoughts, Mr. Morale and the Big Steppers, part 1 and part 2.